Yeah. So you are in your second year, your PhD now?
Yeah, second year, like 1 year, 7 months, something like that.
Okay.
Six, 7 months.
Yeah. So how did you feel? How was the start? How did you feel in the beginning?
I mean, I started in 2015 when I started my master's.
Okay.
So, I mean, initially, obviously, if you have never been outside India, which was in my case, so you will like, I mean, just you need some time to getting used to all these things, like the supermarkets and the transport system and the bikes and all those things. By bikes, I mean bicycles, because everyone here use cycle to, I mean, that's very popular. That's a good thing, which I like here is you can use a cycle and you can go anywhere you want. Like, I mean, most of the things are very close by, unless you go to some other cities, then you can use the, because public transport normally for short distances is very expensive. So
How did you start searching for a PhD? You referred some particular website or anything like that?
academic transfer, I think I have mentioned that in one of the PhD videos. I don't remember which one. Any Dutch university, if you want PhD, only for the Dutch universities, any research position, PhD or anything, that's the best website, because every vacancy is posted in that, irrespective of any university, any position, any track, any faculty. They always post a position, the advertisement in the academic transfer, that's for sure. And if you want for the whole Europe, then you can look for other websites like the euraccess.ceu or something like that. I mean, Euraccess has different branches, but Euraccess is the site for outside people. Like, I know some people from Iran, they came to do PhD here and they found the positions from Euraccess. So some people outside of Netherlands don't know about academic transfer unless they have some contacts, so they look for Euraccess, which is more global for the whole Europe. But specific Netherlands, academic transfer is the best.
How was the interview process like? See, I'm doing my master's now, so I'm in the second year. Don't have any publications as such. I attended one national level conference where I presented one paper, but I don't think it will be considered. It was on smart mirror, I'm not so
I
confident.
mean, it depends on the, I mean, publication is always an advantage, but if you don't have publications, or if you have that one that you mentioned, so it depends on the quality, like the conference that you presented. If the quality is good, then I mean, it depends on what type of, was it something like, I don't know, in your field, which conferences are considered, I mean, on international level, I mean, like with good impact factor and these kind of things.
Okay, so I'm currently doing my internship at RSA, RSA Security, which
Okay,
is
okay. So you are interested in security and cryptography or something like that, or cyber security, or
I'm interested in data science. So my internship is
okay.
on data science right now. So I'm
So
specifically.
what I mean is that depending on what research you are doing now, you can, I mean, you need to streamline your focus, right? I mean, data science is too broad. So depending on what is your thesis or whatever you're doing in your project, master year, last year project, you, when you apply for the PhD, you need to be specific for that stream, I mean, that subfield in the data science, right? Like, that's what I meant, like,
Okay, so
because if you say data science, that's already too vast.
by my university rules, there is no compulsion that I should present a thesis or I should write a thesis of what I'm doing in my internship. So is it okay if we don't have any publications or theses like that? Do you think
No,
it
I mean, thesis thing is not an issue, because I don't know what happens in IIT or NIT, because many people are hired from IIT, NIT, and also some from the state universities. I don't remember the name, but I have heard some people they got in chemical engineering and other faculties in Delft. So there are people who are getting from India, so I don't think that the education system should be an issue. But publication thing, I mean, based on my experience, they always, in 90% of the advertisement, they mention there that if you have one or two publications, it's not even two, it's always asked like one, then it's an advantage, but it's not mandatory. I mean, they don't consider it. It depends on the pool of applicants. So if you're lucky, then maybe in that pool who apply for that position, there will be people who don't have publications at all. Or if someone has it, then depends also on the rest of the profile. So 90% of the cases, if you don't have publication, you should not be that much worried. Like, you need to strengthen your other things, like when you write the motivation letter or the SOP, whatever they call it. I mean, for that position, when you write the 2-page or something, they ask the motivation letter or the statement of purpose, that you need to define it as a good story. Like, how, I mean, what is your interest that you are applying for that position, and what you offer and what they expect from you, depending on that advertisement, what you read in the while applying for that position. So when you don't have publication, you can strengthen these parts, like the SOP and your CGPA, which you cannot change. You can just have what you have now and those kind of things.
Okay. So using the motivation letter or the statement of purpose should be written so well that it speaks more about my interests. And
yeah, what... I mean, you so that you can create that bridge, like suppose what position you're applying is perfectly matching to what they expect, that's fine. But if you feel that your interest is somewhat different and you are somehow trying to make it look that this is the way I'll go, and it will be a bridge, like a connection. So that thing you need to establish in the SOP, so that when someone reads it, then they can feel it. That's the thing. Like, it should be made clear. So because it is very short, so in that short text, you should be able to explain your the main thing that they expect.
Okay. And how will be the competition like in India? We see that
that thing is really, really difficult to say, because most of the cases, I mean, I know because during my time I applied for like I applied for 20 or 30, but I got selected for the till the interview round in only four or three, I don't remember. Oh, it was four. One in TU Delft, one here, and one in KU Leuven. One in, what is that called? I don't remember. There are four universities. So the thing is that reveal at the end when you're hired as a PhD, they don't reveal how many people applied and among how much people they selected you, because every PhD position here is like you are as an employee, you are not as a student when you start a PhD. So you get an employee contract and everything works like it's like a job. So some positions, depending on the demand in that and the professor's reputation and all those things, some positions have more applicants, some have less, but there is no number. I mean, that's very difficult to say. That's what I'm saying, because you can feel, or I mean, you can never ask them, obviously, but you can feel or maybe know from others how many people applied in that faculty. If you know any PhDs in that faculty, I mean, suppose you are applying for civil and you know some people in that university who are doing PhD in that faculty, maybe you can ask them and they can offer you something. But even in my case, if someone asks in my university what is the acceptance ratio or something like that, it's very difficult to say, because I mean, sometimes there will be only 5 PhDs for that position. Sometimes there are 20. But normally, I know that I can say the numbers. It's between 10 to 30 or 5 to 20, something like that, for one position, total number of applicants. And that also depends, like, because generally in one position, there will be one PhD. But sometimes that position itself is very vast, so they subdivided it into two PhDs. Then you'll have, like, if it is an industrial PhD, sometimes during industrial PhD, they have a big project, like some million euros or something like that. So in that case, you will have like subdivided focus or themes, and you'll have like 17 PhDs. Broadly, the topic is same, but everyone will work in different focus. So in that way, you can, I mean, if you're applying for something which is at like 16, 17, you hear something which is rarely found, then you might feel you have a higher chance. That is what you can say or feel, but it's really difficult to say exactly how many people apply, and because nothing is official. Like these positions, they get funding from these projects and then they open it and it varies. But as I said, the number varies between somewhere roughly 5 to 20 or 30, something like that. But it's really difficult to say proportion. Like, I mean, you have higher competition or lower competition or something like that.
Mm-hmm. And as you mentioned, so PhD is considered as an employment, right? It is not. Okay. So
and the whole Netherlands, that is the case. I mean, whole of Netherlands. There are many places in Europe, but in Netherlands, at least, it's the case.
Okay. So at the end of the internship, we'll have around 4 years of experience. That is what I can make out.
Internship? Right. Sorry?
Sorry. At the end of the PhD.
Yeah. I mean, I mean, I don't mean that suppose you apply for a job, they'll treat it like you will get a PhD degree and certificate, but the nature of your work will be different than if you are in US or other places in Europe, like Norway or something, where you are a student and you have to do some subjects or courses where you earn ECTS and you have a mandatory teaching. Here, teaching is optional. Sometimes they have some teaching, sometimes you have zero. It depends on the universities. But your work is always like employee. So you have the bonus and everything. I mean, it's much luxurious as compared to other parts. That's the straight thing. Like, you have other tasks because you are doing projects while doing PhD. So you're also part of the project. Sometimes your work may be higher, but the overall salary and the scene is very luxurious on the surface.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And one more thing is, one of your videos, you mentioned about finding a mentor or a supervisor. So
I remember that.
Yeah, in your PhD course itself, will not be there a supervisor assigned to you? Or you have to find
some. What happens is generally when you, I mean, if you find a supervisor beforehand, like suppose you are doing a master thesis, and I'm giving one example to make it clear. So suppose during a master thesis, you are very lucky and you worked really hard, and at the end of your thesis, you have a publication and you go to some of the conference that is towards the end of your master's, and you meet some people in your field who are working in your field. And you just talk with them and suddenly they find that, okay, this guy is really suitable for my for the work that we are doing in our labs, and they might offer you some positions. Or maybe you find that this person is really interesting, and after you go back, you mail them and then they later reply in positive, and luckily you end up in matching in that. So that is one way of saying like an accidental finding of a promoter or a supervisor, as they call it, promoter here. Like the professor is called promoter, the professor who is part of a supervision team. So that is one accidental way. And if you are doing masters here, maybe sometimes depending on your hard work and depending on their openings, you might get PhD in the same faculty that in which you did masters under the same supervisor or that same research group in which you are working. If you have like a open position in there, or they also feel, I mean, sometimes you might feel, but they might not feel. That will be very clear when you do your, I mean, that is one way. But in your case, as you are coming from outside, so in your case, like either you can email some people. That is what I was discussing 2 hours back with someone else. Like apart from looking into academic transfers, you can email some specific professors if you find any match, like a short email without describing much, attaching a CV or something like that. Or, I mean, the thing is, when you have the PhD interview, normally the supervisor is always there in the interview. I mean, the person that interviews you, one or two of them, there will be committee, they will be interested to supervise you. That's why they interview. So from that exchange, you can easily know whatever may be your before experience. From that exchange, you can easily be sure that whether you want that person to be your supervisor or are you comfortable or not. I mean, it's not always the case that they are okay, but you also should be okay depending on how you feel about the, because you need to stay with them for 4 years. So
yeah.
Should not be like you just go there because he has a lot of citations and you are not comfortable, then there's no point of going there. Like, so it should be both of the things. So that's the thing, like, it's not that you are entering a PhD because you are not a student. So you are not entering a PhD and you don't have anyone to supervise you. They come after 6 months. It is never the case. Most of the 99% of the cases, whoever does your interview will be your part of your supervision. That's why they do the interview. I mean, they are interested in you and you are also going to be. And generally, you have like one daily supervisor and one promoter. That is one professor. Sometimes if you are lucky, or I don't know, you should say it luck or not. I mean, in my case, there are like two promoters and one supervisor. So how I have two promoters, that is a different story. Like, I mean, one of them was associate professor. And when he hired me after that, he became full professor. So that's why they are supervising. It's like promoter and co-promoter. So, but in most cases, you'll have one, like one daily supervisor who will be assistant or associate professor and one full professor. And I mean, the thing is here, you need to come forward. I mentioned that in one video, I think, I don't remember, like, you need to be, I think in the bachelor's video, I mentioned 1 week back that you need to always come forward from your side. And it's always like that. I mean, they don't expect that they will come and solve your problems, but you need to come and approach them again and again when you have your supervisor team, and then they will always find time to give you once a week or once every 2 weeks or something like that. I mean, in my case, we meet always once a week. Even my professor gives like 30 minutes or something every week, which is really well, I mean, really high in my case, because they are so busy that if they can spare 30 minutes, that's really huge every week.
Okay. So, and how was the interview like? It was technical round, and then
generally they don't have technical because they evaluate you from your, I mean, suppose you're coming from India, so they will see your internship or project or whatever you've done. In our case, it was the thesis, and I had one publication only, that was towards the end of my master's. So in our position also, it is mentioned that publication is not mandatory, but if you have, that's good, well and good. So the thing is, like, it's not hard, but it's a different way. I mean, there is not like in India, you have a technical round, you need to explain something or something like that. It's not like that. So basically, there are always two rounds. One first will be the Skype round, where you can do the Skype anywhere in the world, wherever you are. And if they're satisfied with that, then they will ask you to come to the campus for the on-campus interview, where you'll have most of the time, you'll have all the supervision team will be there who wants to supervise you, or maybe some of them. And this Skype interview, they generally ask something which is related to what you have done before, like in the last year of a master's, if you have done a thesis or a project or internship or your background, and maybe if you have worked in any projects, or if you have publication, then some. So they want to know about your background, and later they might ask, how does it relate? Like, I mean, they will also judge something based on a motivation letter, but sometimes they ask some questions if they find something very contradictory or something which they want to verify further, or maybe just to more clarification, like, you have mentioned this here, and did you do this, or how do you think that this will help you during your PhD, or something like that, like very basic questions. And if you are qualified in the Skype round, then you come for the second round. In the second round, that is the campus round, you can check in the video also. I mentioned that, like, I think I made two videos on that. Like, did you see one video where someone was asking in Skype about the TU Delft interview? So there I mentioned most of the things that happens in the second round. There's like a 15 minutes talk. So you can see that. I'll tell you in brief. So it's like, I mean, they ask you to write a short proposal. 99% of the universities do that in Netherlands. Also in Belgium, because I had some experience in Belgium also. So Belgium also, they do that. So they ask you to write like one page. It's very short, they want to know. I mean, I don't think I mean, you can look at different examples, because in that video, I gave a link in the description of that video, the interview in TU Delft. So in the description, you can click on that link and see there is a template which will make your doubts more clear, like how you write the research proposal, which is asked in 99% of the cases in the second round. So it's like very brief of what you are going to do in your PhD. Suppose you are assigned beforehand to a project, then it will be related to that. Otherwise, if you don't have a particular topic yet, they might say to come up, they will give you freedom to think of anything that you will do specific in the PhD. It need not be that that is what you are going to do when you start the PhD, but they just want to see how is your research bent of mind, like the critical thinking and all other skills. So you don't need to innovate something or something. It's that one page which you'll see when you click on the link. So there you mention like brief background of what you are explaining them you want to do, and the research questions, which is basically you ask what you want to explore. When you see the template, you'll understand. And on the research questions specifically, I made another video in week 8, I think. There you can see how you frame your research question, because when I started my master thesis, it took me like 1 or 2 months to understand actually what is a research question. It is a very basic, simple thing, but sometimes when you don't have that background, sometimes you might feel some time to get the grasp of the things, but once you get it, then it's very easy. Like, because that is always important before you code anything or do any experiments or anything. You should have a clear thing in your mind, like what is your goal, like the objective you want to achieve with that time frame. That is what you define in a research question. So those are the things you need to take care when you write that one pager for the on-campus interview. And in that, most of the things are based on that. So they will ask to present those one page ideas in like 2-3 slides, 3-4 minutes. They want it very short to get just the overview of the idea in like 2-3 minutes. And most of the questions will be on that. And that lasts for approximately, like, depending on the university, max 60 minutes. It can be as low as 25-30 minutes. So it will be between 30 to 60 minutes. And that's it. I mean, that's the last round. So, I mean, they don't specifically test for code or something, like, but they will know from your profile and how you talk, because they have so much experience. So they will know whether you will be able to do that or this. Unless you don't have experience, then obviously they won't invite you for the campus interview if they feel that this is not exactly matching or 50% matching or something like that.
You had a whiteboard and you explained how the allowances are. I mean, you explained something about TA, HRA and all. So do you think, I just want to know from you, if 2,300 euros, how is it like living in Netherlands with that amount?
If you come as a PhD directly here, then you'll get much higher salary as compared to me. Like, you get some kind of a tax benefit, so for that 30% of the money, it is non-taxable. So that's why we pay the full tax. So we get what Dutch people get as a PhD. So what we get is around, what we get in second year is around 2,200 euros after tax and bonus and everything, 2,300 or something like that. But you will get like 300, 400 euros more. So your salary will be somewhere around 2,500 euros or 600, something like that, because you get the 30% ruling. So you have more tax benefit. 2,500 here is way a lot, like it's really huge. Like, cost to savings ratio, if you see, unless you stay in Amsterdam, you'll pay for house like roughly around 500. It increases every year. So it might be somewhere around 600, maybe after 1 or 2 years. A private housing with sufficient space and everything, which you don't share with anyone, you can get for including electricity and everything for 500 euros, something like that. Or maybe 600, because every year it increases, and depending on the place you go, unless you go to Amsterdam is really expensive. So and food and all, if you cook occasionally, you can like eat easily in 150 or 200 euros. So I mean, if you spend on traveling also and some leisure activity or anything with 1,000 euro, you can easily survive and rest of your will be savings. And if you spend a lot also in buying anything or gadgets or garments or any gifts or anything, then also you'll save, like either you save because you get 30%, so either you'll save 1,500 euros every month or you'll save 1,000 euros if you spend very lavishly or something like that. So that's way, way like, I mean, that's sufficient money. As a that's why I said as a PhD, the way of nature of the life you get here is much, much better than what you get in US. I mean, there are other things beneficial there, but I'm just saying, like, if you're working there, it's different, but doing a PhD here is much, much better.
Okay. So, yeah, so Academic Transfer is one website which you mentioned for Netherlands, and EurAccess is the other one which you mentioned for across Europe, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So, yeah, so these are the questions which I had. So, yeah, that's all I had to ask. And I have to compliment you for starting your YouTube channel, and you are helping a lot of people. So time is something which you are giving, which is very, very valuable. And thank you, man. Keep up the good work.
Yeah. You are welcome.
Yeah. I'll definitely stay in touch with you.
No problem.